Let's begin with prayer. Father, we thank you and we claim the promises of your word that you have so generously purchased for us by the blood of Jesus on the cross of Calvary. And so we stand right now amazed at your goodness. And Father, we thank you. We thank you. We're not trying to get something. We thank you. We honor you, for you are our source. You are the supply. And you are more than enough. You are more than enough. You are more than enough. You are El Shaddai. You are more than enough. I thank you, Father God, for your goodness. I thank you for your grace. We praise you and worship you today. Come on, just lift your hands and worship them right now. We worship you, Father, that even the challenges at hand that some may be dealing with, they are not the priority. You are the priority. You are the priority. You are the center of our world. We worship you. We honor you. We praise you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your truth. We thank you the entrance of your word gives us light and directs and guides us. We thank you, Father, for empowering us today. I thank you, Father God. I speak a blessing in the lives of your people today. Lord, I thank you for strength and might in the inner man by the Holy Spirit in their life today. I thank you that no one under the sound of my voice will leave the same, but they'll walk away changed by your anointing, changed by your truth, changed by your Holy Spirit. We thank you that they're stronger today than yesterday. I thank you, Father God, for greater hope, greater faith, greater power imparting into their lives today. Wherever they are, whatever they need, whatever they are dealing with, whatever opportunities lie ahead, I thank you. Thanks be to God who always causes them to be victorious, and we give you praise. I thank you, Father God. We worship you. We worship you. We worship you in spirit and in truth. I thank you for the tangibility of your power, the tangibility of your presence that so moves beyond an emotion or a moment, but brings catastrophe to the armies of the enemy and brings victory to us today. I thank you, Father God, that you are doing what no man could do. For with man it's impossible, but with you all things are possible. And so we rejoice in that today. We celebrate to that in that today, that you are good. You are good, Father God. There is none good but one. There is none good but you. You are good. We worship you today, Father God. We love you with all our heart, soul, and mind. We love you, Father. We love you, Father. We love you, Father God. We repent if we ever got distracted from our focus being on you. Lord, we set our affection on things above. We love you today, Father God. We love you today, Father God. We love you today. We worship you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, worship him right where you're at. We will never be the same. We're changed, forever changed by your presence and your power. Hallelujah. We love you, Jesus. We love you. We praise your name, Lord Jesus. We lift your name up on high. We lift your name up on high. We lift your name up on high. And Father, we thank you for the miracles that are about to happen. We thank you for the testimonies that are going to be communicated. We thank you for saving people today. We thank you for not only in this service, but the second and third service, Father God. We thank you for your plans that you already prepared in advance. We thank you for everyone that's going to be blessed, everyone that's going to be touched, everyone that's going to be healed, saved, and delivered. We thank you for your goodness, Father God. Manifesting in a way that even the sinners can see it. Manifesting, bringing a change that even the world can notice it. And we give you praise. We honor you today. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Father God. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 I'm telling you, Jesus said it. He said, I'm the vine, you're the branch. I encourage you, stay connected to Jesus. If you abide in me, my words abide in you, then you'll ask. When you're a branch connected to the vine, all that's in the vine belongs to you. So the branch draws freely from its connection. The branch draws freely based on the connection. The branch draws freely I hear that in my spirit. I wasn't prepared to say that. I have no notes to say that. I was not planning to say that. But are you listening? The branch draws freely from its connection. You're a branch connected to something. You are a branch connected to something. Make sure you're connected to the right thing. When you're connected to the wrong thing, you will draw the wrong stuff. Because the branch draws freely an ample supply from its connection. So I'm a branch. And I choose today to be connected to the vine of Jesus, which is his word. Amen. So as a branch, when you're connected to Jesus, all that is in Jesus belongs to you. Is it okay we do it this way today? All that is in Jesus belongs to you. Say all that's in the vine. All that's in Jesus belongs to me today because I'm connected. Now, didn't Jesus say that even by principle and by scripture? He said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, then you shall ask and you shall have. So we want, but we don't want to always connect. Didn't the Father, as a story about the kingdom principles, didn't the Father say to the prodigal son's brother, didn't he say to his other son that stayed around, he said, son, don't you realize all that I have belongs? Say it belongs. Does it belong to you?
Yes.
See, he didn't understand that all that the Father had belonged to him. And because he didn't understand that all that the Father had belonged to him, he never made a withdrawal. He didn't make a withdrawal. See, when you're connected, you begin to see who Jesus is. And when you see who Jesus is, then you begin to understand not only who he is, but if you understand the principle that you're a branch connected to the vine, then you can say, if it's in Jesus. Say with me, if it's in Jesus, then it belongs to me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, the Bible says in him is the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Hallelujah. That means all power of heaven is in Jesus. Hallelujah. All goodness of heaven. I'm telling you, all the healing of heaven is in Jesus. All the peace of heaven is in Jesus. All the joy of heaven is found in Jesus. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Hallelujah. We call the order of heaven into your life today. That's the will of God. I call the order of heaven into your life today. I call the joy of heaven into your life today. I call the peace of heaven. Now, if you want it, start making the draw. You know what that means? That means on the inside, say, yeah, I want to receive that. I receive it. Something stirs on the inside. And out of your mouth, say, I receive that by faith.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. There's a desire on the inside that says, yeah, I'm going to draw. All that belongs to Jesus belongs to you. You're the heir of God, joint heir with Christ. Hallelujah. So if that's true, and if you and I, if we're the branch and we're connected to the vine, see, it's the vine's responsibility to get the nourishment. It's the branch's responsibility to produce the fruit.
Right.
Matthew 13, get the word in you, and that word produces the change.
Yes.
But you have to make a choice
right.
to receive. You have to make a choice to receive. You have to make a choice. Revelation 3, Jesus said, I stand at the door and I'm knocking. If you hear my word, if you hear my voice, what is this voice? If you hear what he's saying, if you receive the word, then open up and I'll come in. Hallelujah. Didn't the word of God, didn't he say in the word of God that the word that went forth did not bring a change to some because they did not mix their faith with it. They didn't believe it. They didn't act upon it. They were like, yeah, whatever. Can we get going? Because I missed some of the March Madness college games yesterday, and I got them recorded, and I want to get home and watch them. Can we move this thing along? If you want it to move along, you won't get anything. Hallelujah. But when you know the word's going forth, it's the water. Jesus said to the disciples, now you're clean by the washing of the water of the word. Isaiah 55:11 says, as the word goes forth, it will not return void. I don't need my word. You don't need my word. We need God's word today. And when you come hungry, say, God, I'm so hungry. I need a word from heaven for me today. When you come in with the expectation of, I need a word from heaven for me today. I praise God for people getting excited, but I want to get excited. Praise God for people getting a blessing, but I want the blessing. Praise God for people getting healed. I want the healing. I want my word for today. And all of a sudden, you get so determined on the inside that you want something from heaven today. All of a sudden, you begin to draw. You begin to make a withdrawal from the word of God. You're mixing your faith. And oh, when you understand that it's all of heaven's best is found in Jesus. Jesus said, all power, all power in heaven. Why am I going over these verses? Because the Holy Spirit must want someone to keep hearing them, so to waken us up. Because sometimes we hear with deaf ears. We don't hear with hearing ears. Didn't Jesus say, all power in heaven and in earth, hallelujah, just not in heaven, but even in the earth, is given unto me. That means all heaven's power is found in Jesus, in that name, hallelujah. And if he's the vine and I'm connected as a branch, I have access to draw heaven's best into my life, hallelujah. Say, I receive what is available to me today. Now, Jesus had to get Martha and Mary. We're gonna move right into this. How interesting. Jesus had to get Martha and Mary to understand this, because if they didn't understand him, they couldn't withdraw from him, receive from him. Right. You can say receive, same thing, withdraw. Receive, same thing. We look at receiving like I'm waiting for somebody to drop it on my back porch. No. Receiving is the same thing as making a withdrawal. Amen. Receiving is making a withdrawal. It's the same thing. Just the way we say it in our English words, we can misunderstand what's happening. Some of us think receiving is passive. No, receiving or making a, when you say withdraw, it makes a little more clarity in my mind, because making a withdrawal, you know, to make a withdrawal from the bank, you can't sit at home.
Right.
Now I take that back. With technology, you can do a lot of stuff, can't you? Hallelujah. But back in the day, come on, work with me. Back in the day, you had to go someplace. You had to fill out a withdrawal slip. And based on the size amount of it, they're going to ask you for identification. If you don't know who he is, then you won't know who you are. And if you don't know who you are, well, this is who I am. I'm not asking your address. I'm not asking your last name. I'm asking your identity in Christ. You're a branch. Say, I'm a branch. Come on, say, I'm a branch. That's all you need to know. Everything in your past doesn't make a difference anymore. You're a branch connected to the vine, hallelujah. Connected to the source of heaven. Connected to the ample supply of your heavenly Father. Connected to the Godhead, but all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Connected to all power, amen. All the other stuff you can just forget at the moment, because the key is you're the branch. And he's the vine. And so when Mary and Martha was dealing with their worst case scenario, John's Gospel chapter 11, their brother died. They were mad and frustrated with Jesus because he didn't show up in the role they understood him to be. They knew him. The tension was that they knew him as the healer. And so you need a healer when you're dealing with sickness. But the healer for the sickness didn't show up. And they were frustrated that he didn't come in the way of their understanding. Your tension against God will come when he doesn't show up at your level of understanding. But I'm here to tell you, he still loves you. But what you have to realize is that he's greater than your understanding. And when he showed up, they didn't say, "Woo, I'm glad you're here." They said, "What took you so long?" Greg Bruce translation, you read any way you want. What took you so long? Say, what took you so long? Have you ever thought that about God in your own prayer time? What's taking you so long? Maybe you're not seeing him correctly. And so what did Jesus do with Martha? He began to clarify her vision. He began to clarify her perspective. See, these things aren't obvious to everybody. You know, it's like one of those things, if it's easy, everybody would do it. If your promised land was easy to get to, by the time you got there, there'd be too many people and there wouldn't be no room for you. The very fact that you have a promised land that even might have giants in it, you shouldn't cry about that because he's giving you power over those giants. But if you don't understand that, when you get to, you'll cry. No, you ought to rejoice because those giants have intimidated a lot of posers and poachers and people, squatters, and want to come and take what God has for you without qualifying by what the promises of God. Come on, somebody. If it was easy, it would already be filled. There wouldn't be no room for you. But no, what the enemy meant for evil, God will turn for good. Hallelujah. Because when you show up, it's just not you. You have an understanding. You have a revelation. That's a rhema. That's the word of God being revealed to you by the Spirit of God. Come from heaven. Come from heaven. And that gives you the power of a sword. Because the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. It's the word revealed to you, not just any. It's your sword. Because he told you to take it. You don't take what doesn't belong to you unless you're a thief. And Jesus doesn't want you to be a thief. That's the enemy side. He's the good side. One of you have life and life more abundantly. So you need a word. You need a revelation. You need a sword. And when it becomes revealed to you, Deuteronomy 29 says, then it belongs to you. The secret things belong to God, but the things revealed belong to you. Can I get an amen? Stay with me. It's the mysteries. 1 Corinthians 2 says that we speak these things in mysteries because they're not revealed to everybody. That the carnal mind, the natural mind, cannot receive the things of God because they're foolishness to them. Because they're spiritual things that must be revealed. Yes. Spiritual things that must be revealed. Right. If I can explain it just in pure logic, you haven't caught the entirety of it. Because there's some stuff that has to be revealed by the Spirit of God to your spirit. Yes. Not with the natural mind, but with a revelation. Did you hear me? Yes. Did you hear me? We're going somewhere today. Aren't you glad? Say, this is my breakout year. Hallelujah. I celebrate with you in advance of your breakout year. This year, in Jesus' name. I'm telling you, you have to receive it. See, not everybody wants it. Some people just want, give me the crumbs from the table. Just give me the practical stuff. I don't want the spiritual stuff. But you need the spiritual stuff that gives you power. Some people are like Israel when God said, now bring my people up to the mountain so they can worship me and begin to know me better. And what did Moses do? He came down from the mountain to the people and said, it's time. Woo! Here's your time for you to see what I've seen. Here's your time to hear what I've been hearing. Here's your time to know who I've gotten to know. Hallelujah. And you know what they said? Oh, we don't want to go there. We don't want that. You go and then just tell us. You bring it to our understanding. And no, but there's stuff that you will never get until you experience it and let the Spirit of God reveal it to you. It's a mystery of the kingdom. In fact, the Bible says, if the devil would have known, 1 Corinthians 2, read it your own time. If the devil would have known the plan of the Father, he would never have crucified Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Woo, I feel an anointing in this first service. I don't know about you. Thank you, Jesus. If the devil would have known, I'm telling you, if the devil would have known that trying to mess with you, God was going to turn and make you a victor, even in the midst of a battle, he wouldn't have messed with you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so he's trying to get Mary and Martha. And so these things are revealed. Say it has to be revealed. That you got to ask the Holy Spirit to show you, because some things in the practical, when you talk about spiritual things, they don't always make sense in the practical. Giving is one of those. Yeah. I'm not taking up a special offering today, so relax. But you know what has happened in the church world? Is we have, I'll say we as church, right. Church world, they have pressured people to give. Because we, and some pastors do it out of true, genuine desire to see you blessed. Some do it because they want your money to manipulate you. I've had people say, oh, I know what I can do with their money, so I'm always thinking of ways that, well, I'm not going there. We don't need to go there. See, because when you give out of pressure, you miss the blessing. That's why the Bible says God doesn't want someone to give out of compulsion. He wants someone to give. God loves a cheerful giver because a cheerful giver gives, which makes no natural sense. But a cheerful giver gives with joy because they have a revelation. If you give out of pressure, do you know what you're doing? You are just pulling down that slot, hoping, and they all line up for you.
Come on.
You are gambling with God, and it doesn't work that way.
Right.
I'm telling you, if you think, even when we take up offerings, we don't put people under pressure. We want you to hear from God. You obey God. You obey God with the tithe. Tithing is something you might grow up and did it automatically and not got the revelation. I'm telling you, tithing's a powerful connection with covenant with God and the local ministry and what God's doing. Offerings is a great tool. But when the devil starts messing with you, you start thinking, I don't know if I believe this. Don't fight it and don't be forced to do it. Are you listening to me? Pray, Lord, if this is the real deal, make it real to me. This is a journey of a relationship, folks. And if you don't have the revelation, just pray, God, if this is the real deal, then show me, Jesus. Because if it's from you and it will bless me and help other people, I want to get into the system of God. I want to get into the economy of God's system, right? Don't you? I mean, if God has his own economy system where he can bless you and make you the head and not the tail and have you more than enough, don't you want in that system? So I challenge you, don't give by pressure. If it doesn't make sense to you, say, God, show me. And begin to dig into his word and find out. I had a person I was witnessing to one-on-one years ago, and they were atheists. All the reasons why God doesn't exist. Which is interesting. How can anybody hate God or believe that he don't exist? How do you believe something in the absence of it anyway? So they hated God. Didn't believe. So I guess that would make him more of an agnostic than an atheist. But I don't want to argue with the person who's mad at God. And so they were telling me why God doesn't exist. And I said, well, okay, let's leave it with this. It's because you can't argue with some people. I said, would you be willing to pray a simple prayer? Not even the prayer of salvation. I said, would you be willing to pray, Jesus, if you're real, make yourself real to me in a way that I know you're real. And then I said, and then look at this. If you pray it and he's real and he shows you, then you know. If you pray it and you mean it and he doesn't show you, then don't you think you're safe because then he must not exist. What if you don't answer? That's his problem, not mine. I'm not Jesus.
Right?
But if someone is open to pray it, even I challenge you, just Lord, if you want me to tithe, you want me to give, if this is your system, show me. Come on, somebody. Let's get away from money. Some of you get too nervous when I talk about money. Why do you talk about money? Because everybody deals with money. So it's something everybody relates to. But he had to get Martha and Mary into the context. He had to get Martha and Mary into the context to see who he was. And so Martha was frustrated. Have you ever been frustrated with God? And said, Lord, why haven't you been here? Lazarus would not have died if you would have came with healing. You're the healer. We had someone who's sick that we loved, and you should have been here to deal with the sickness because you're the healer. But because you weren't here when he was sick, we've missed our opportunity for a miracle because it's too late now because now he's dead, and you're the healer. But he's dead. A dead person doesn't need a healer. A dead person needs someone who resurrect. But you came, and you're too late, and so we're mad at you. You just got to read the Bible the way you want to read the Bible, but keep it in line with the word of God. But that's how, right? John 11, Lord, if you'd been here, he wouldn't have died. She was hopeless because her hopeless was tied to the definition of Jesus the way she knew him in the past. But she didn't understand. He was trying to reveal to her the Jesus of the present. Because the role of the past wasn't needed today. It was a role that she had yet to see. And Jesus said, Martha, your brother's going to rise again. I know he's going to rise again in the last day. No, 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 no. I am the resurrection. I am the life. Well, I'm sorry. We've gone so far. I haven't even got to one of my scriptures, so my media team's probably mad at me, and we're almost out of time. We're trying to get somewhere today. I think we're going someplace. Amen? He said, I am the resurrection. Say, Jesus is the resurrection. Jesus is the life. See what's happening? He's revealing to her what's in the vine. Hallelujah. What's in the vine? Why would he care? Why don't you just raise Lazarus? Why do you care? Because he needs somebody in that world, in this world, within that realm of authority to understand his identity. Because he needs somebody to make a withdrawal. Remember the woman with the issue of blood who said within herself, if I can just but touch the hem of his garment, I know I'll be made whole. And her, with her sickness and blowing all her money on doctors that did not help her but made her worse, she pushed through the crowd. I mean, she took a risk because in that culture, she was not allowed to be with the public. She could not interact with society and definitely be in a crowd and push against them. But she made her way in the crowd to get to Jesus. You know, when you're going to make a withdrawal, you get so hungry that you are going to make a way to get to Jesus. I'm telling you, there's been times in my life, I'm like, I have to touch Jesus today. I don't care what song's being sung. I don't care what's being preached. I'm coming in with the desire. I'm going to touch the Jesus that I need today. And he's got something for me. And she made her way and touched the hem of his garment. Not to get too deep, but what we have to understand, we look at the hem at the end of the clothing. What the hem was the knots of a string that was attached to the corner of his prayer shawl. It represented the laws of the covenant. She was saying, if I can get a hold of just not the word, if I can get a hold of the commandments of the covenant. You said, that's the Old Testament. Yeah, because that's what they operated under. And Deuteronomy says that if you don't obey me, these are all the curses. But if you do obey me, here's all the blessing. What was she saying? Let me break it down because we're lacking, running out of time. What was she? Ooh, I'm having fun now. I don't know about you, but I'm sitting here enjoying church. What was she saying? What she was saying is, if I could connect to his achievements. Because Jesus said, I didn't come to destroy the law. Study it out. I didn't come to destroy the law. I came to fulfill the law. And if he came to fulfill the law, the obedience of the Father, then all of these promises of blessing belong to him. If I can get a hold of his obedience, I can get a hold of his blessing from his obedience because I can't do it in my own. Hallelujah. Doesn't Galatians tell us that? That under the curse, but Jesus became a curse so that he can remove the curse out of your life. And so when the curse tries to creep in, say, no, 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 that sickness, that poverty, that's under the curse, Deuteronomy tells me. And I'm not under the curse anymore because I'm connected to. Yeah. I'm a branch connected to the vine. And all that's in Jesus belongs to me. All that's in Jesus. Ooh, when you get a revelation of who he is, when you get a revelation, the name of the Lord is a strong tower, the righteous run into it, and when you get a revelation on who he is, then you can make a withdrawal. Hallelujah. 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 See, I'm making a withdrawal today. Shh. What did he tell Martha? I am the resurrection of life. Hallelujah. 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 We might not get to any notes today, but that's okay. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, let's at least throw up Ephesians 1. What is the exceeding greatness of his power? Hallelujah. Well, what is the exceeding greatness of his power? Hallelujah. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power? Which he, look, toward us who believe. How do you make that withdrawal? I'm believing. How do you know if you're believing? You're obeying because he told Martha. Come on. If you believe, she said, I believe, Lord. Then he said, move the stone. Oh, I can't obey. If you can't obey, then you don't believe. Because his correction to her was, didn't I tell you before? Yeah. That means I already told you once. Aren't you glad that he's merciful and gracious to you? That sometimes when you don't get it the first time, he'll come back and remind you of what he's already revealed to you before. Don't you remember what I said before? That if you believe, you will see. Hallelujah. Your obedience to what you believe in align with the word is connecting you, allowing you to make a withdrawal. Because the withdrawal is not passive. Receiving is not passive. Receiving is active. That don't make sense to our natural mind when we expect receiving to fall into our lap. No, you got to make a withdrawal. Yeah. It's an active process. It's an active process. It's like listening. You can hear, but listening is active. Right. Did you hear what I said? Know what you say to me? That's passive, you forget. Active, you hook on. Right. Hallelujah. Say, I'm a branch connected to the vine. Woo, we're going to end here. I don't know where else to go because we haven't got any of the notes. But I believe that was for somebody today. Amen. See, I'm making a withdrawal of the exceeding greatness of his power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead. That's the next part of that verse. Which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead. That's resurrection power. That's resurrection power. Some of you need a healing. But some of you need resurrection. Yes. When you understand, have a revelation of his resurrection, hallelujah, you can make a draw. I got to stop here. I'll be here by the end of the third service if we don't stop. Amen. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah.